I don't know what to do. And he said, well, why don't you try this? And it'd be what I had written on the paper. Once you do that, you start feeling confident about it. So my advice is to find good people and learn from them. And you can experiment all you want, but experiment on sound principles. Because a lot of the things that are innovative or new age, and I'm labeled as old school, which whatever that is, so be it. I stand by my record. You know, Greg Troy, we're the pounders. Although you saw my mileage, just the 50,000 a week. I don't know where they get that. Even though we might not do it the same way and people get good results, who are they getting good results with? At what part of the developmental process are they getting these results? You know, the things we do at North Baltimore Aquatic Club largely are geared towards developmental athletes. And then at the top level, we just kind of continue that development curve. So I think those are the things that you should really consider when you're starting out. Don't be afraid to ask a great coach a question. When I first went to the Ask a Clinic in 1986, still have my coffee mug, Paul Bergen spoke, and I heard this guy, first time I ever heard him. I was like, my God, this guy knows everything there is to know about swimming. So for the rest of those 3 days, I just followed him around. Never spoke to him, right? And the odd thing is, you know, 10 years later, we're out in Carneros shoveling horse manure together, you know. He would have talked to me for hours if I'd just asked a question. But I just would follow him in the exhibit hall, whatever he looked at, I'd look at. When he went in a restaurant, I'd sit in the next booth and try to overhear what he was saying. But if I had had any guts at all, I could have asked him 100 questions and he would have talked to me all day. And I think most of the coaches are that way. So if you have a question for some coaches that have, you know, achieve some things, they're happy to help you. Did you have a question? Were you going to ask them? Yeah? Oh, I thought you were. Yeah. Did, okay. Good. We have a rather long letter that I'd like to read to you. No, I don't. It's just a bunch of questions. How much verbal communication do you have with athletes during practice? That's a great question. As it says, for example, times, technique, motivation. I look at it this way. You saw yesterday, I give them the whole workout. So they know what the training scheme is. We have pace clocks, and actually ours are digitized, and we program the sets in. So it moves through the whole practice. So there's very little downtime. I despise downtime in practice. I want to use every minute that we have for getting them more fit or making them a better athlete. So I don't like to give long speeches or take a lot of time where their heart rates drop. We try to keep it moving. So between sets, maybe a minute, maybe two, I guess if it's a big set. So you have those two things. You have the pace clock, which kind of runs the practice. You have the scheme. Other than that, my job is to coach technique and provide motivation. And that occurs in the intervals between swims. It can occur while they're swimming. You know, a lot of my athletes, we can communicate with pretty good with hand signals. You know, like while they're swimming, if I want them to get their head down, I came up with this. It's really cool. I just go like that. They put their head down. Or, you know, if you want them, sometimes I get excited. I want them to go faster. I'll whistle or make noise or, you know, put some energy into it. But I would say almost the whole practice, I'm communicating with them on some level. I don't think very often do we just kind of sit back and let them go up and down. I don't feel like I'm earning my money when that happens. Do you have a temper during practice, meets, or ever? How much emotion do you express? Yeah, I do. I think it mainly stems from impatience, but it also, now that I'm older, I do it for effect. Used to be my modus operandi, right? Just yell as much as I could and get, you know, kind of be too enthusiastic all the time. But I think I have to have a toolbox. And another thing as a coach you need to do is develop your coaching toolbox, and it should have a wide variety of tools. There should be a hammer, big one. But it shouldn't be your only tool, because then everything looks like a nail, right? Just go with it. That was my early years. Yeah. Nothing was, you had to hammer everything. But you should have pats on the back. You should have logic. You should have kind of intuition about how to deal with individual people. You should have surprises. You should have little schemes to get them to do things your way when they don't want to. You should have a team of people helping you. So as you go along your coaching path, you're going to keep putting tools in this box. And that's the main goal of coaching, is to have a lot of responses to a given issue. I think that's really important. I think Bill Sweetenham had a little deal where he said, you know, in your first 5 years of coaching, if a problem comes up, you got one way to deal with it, and it's 50-50 whether it'll work or not. In your next 5 years, maybe 5 to 10 years, problem comes up, you probably have 5 different ways that all will work. That was actually decades. It was 10 years, and then the next 10 years, you have about 5 ways all that will work. In your third 10 years of coaching, you don't have a lot of problems because you see them coming and just kind of sidestep them. That's the best part. And then in your fourth 10 years of coaching, which I'm not there yet, I'm still in the third, you create problems to teach people lessons. And that's so true. The people that I know have coached into 40 years of coaching, that's exactly how they work. So I think as you get more tools, you're just more effective in how you deal with things. It's just experience. How much productive time each day on average do you spend planning or working or doing administrative work before practice? It depends on the day. But I would say for every practice that we do, I'm pretty careful about planning practice. So I would say I never spend less than 30 minutes planning a practice. I mean, you know, we all have days where you're in a meeting or something, you got to go in there and you wing it, but those are never very good for me. I'm the kind of person that has to have it pretty detailed, and I want to have it fit into my plan. So I spend it between 30 minutes and an hour putting together the training session itself. And then the rest of the day I try to spend doing other things. One thing I learned, and I have done this for quite a while, is that the most productive hour that you will have is the hour or however much time you can squeeze in before your morning practice. So I know when I was at University of Michigan, I'd get to the, if practice was at 6, I would be at the pool at 4:45, and from 4:45 to 5:45, I could get a whole day's worth of work done. This phone's not ringing, nobody's asking you a question, and it's peaceful. So if you can find an hour like that in your day, it's like doing a whole day's work in that hour. Because once the day starts, you know how it gets, right? Phone rings, you get caught up on putting out fires or things happen, and it kind of gets away from you. I always protect when I'm going to do the practice plan. Typically, I like to go home and think about practice for the next morning. I don't write it like the night before. I will write the practice first thing when I get in. So the first, you know, 30 minutes of that hour, hour and a half that I have, I write the practice, I make the copies, I have it all ready, and then that's there. And then usually right after morning practice, I will write the afternoon practice because things are fresh in my mind about what just happened and I have a good idea, or at least I'll start it. I'll write down some ideas about what we want to do and then maybe think about them for an hour or two and come back and finish it. But I always have it done usually a couple hours before the session starts, because I like to be fully engaged with the athletes when the session starts, not me making copies or anything. It is. It's kind of part of a weekly plan for sure, and in the yearly plan. So I know, depending on what training period we're in, what the emphasis will be, I know what type of training is going to happen that day. But what I like to spend a lot of time doing now is trying to individualize it, and that's what takes the time. Like you saw when we did those training paces for individual swimmers, or I like to think about, a lot of times, I should have shown one with these workouts. I'll have the workout, and then I'll have another page of notes that kind of pertain to each kid and what I'd like to see them do on that set. Sometimes I show them, sometimes I don't. So I think that goes into it as well. And I also write all the results down. I don't write. I have a little elf who helps me write results down during practice. And then I kind of collect all that. I should probably do it online, but I've been doing it on those legal pads forever. The graph paper pads. So I just have like stacks and stacks of them, which I like. I think when I write the workout, it's more personal. I can draw little funny things. And I am more engaged in it than if I typed it. And what I find is the more time I spend planning, the less time I look at it. I never look at the paper during practice, almost never. Because I know it, you just know it so well. You memorize. It's like a musician doing a performance, you memorize it. What is your favorite set and your favorite motivation? I think I've already done this set for every clinic in America. I'll give it to you one more time. Janet Evans. Sorry. If you've seen this before, take a short nap. The pain's almost over anyway. All right. The 2-4-6-8 is freestyle, and it's on some interval where they can move and not have to kill themselves, but it keeps them moving. So, you know, for sake of this discussion, we'll go yards, 220, 440, 7 minutes, 920. And then the 200s, you can be whatever you like. I normally go free IM, which is free back breast free. And I'd say something normal for me might be, I'll do pretty moderate. 230, 225, 220, 215. And this is the emphasis, right? They just kind of work their way down. But it's so versatile. You can do it a million different ways. You can make the 2-4-6-8 free IMs and make that free. Michael's favorite set. That's what he would say is his favorite set. And he, on the last 200 of that, pushed 136-8. Push 137, 136 a few times. So that's what, when he does well on it, that's why, obviously, that's why he likes it. You can do IMs here. You can do stroke. You can do 4 200s back. I do that all the time. You know? So it's very versatile, and you have the endurance component because it goes for quite a while, but you also have a very specific speed component, and they can just do incredible things on this. I used to start out, when I started early in my career, I would always do IMs. And when Michael was like 12, 13, even 13, he'd do his best 200 IM on this like every time. Then he got too fast and had to do it in the meets. What is your favorite motivation? That's a great question. I think my favorite motivation for kids is for them to have, and I don't know if this is motivation, but I think it is for them to have self-discipline. The thing that makes me most happy is when my athletes come in, take care of their business, handle themselves politely, under pressure, know what to do without me having to direct them. And that's, once they learn that, I think it's a motivation in itself. All right. We're kind of moving in now to the more the nuts and bolts things. Energy systems most involved with your capacity training of these swimmers. And examples, here you go, there's one. Really an aerobic system is capacity work in general. I mean, you can have a capacity for doing power work, but for me, building the cup and capacity work is long sets like this that might have a speed component, but in general, they're swimming aerobically most of the time. And the thing that's beautiful about this set is these are really short rests, right? They can't, like, as we would say, muscle it up. They can't just go to a 6-speed kick and big power and get the swim. They can't here, but they can't do this in the middle. They have to swim it with some aerobic capability. So I think that would be the answer to that kind of thing. What's a good dry land swimming ratio for age group level swimmer, pre-senior, high school, college, Olympian, retired? Oh no, they didn't have retired. I was just kidding. I think all levels should do dry land. And it's really, you know, the ratio, I guess, is just time. And it really goes down to how much water time you have and how much water time you want to use. But I would say a good rule of thumb is your youngest age group swimmers, they could do 15 minutes of some kind of dry land, right? The 8 and unders. And then you could go to 30 for the 11, 12s. I love that, 11, 12. Even 13, 14. By the time they're 13, 14, could be 45. And the older guys could do an hour, 45 to an hour, depending on what you want to do. Almost every day. Actually, every day. I like dry land most days, because I just think it's important. for many, many reasons. And that doesn't all have to be strength work. It's running, it's playing games, it's flexibility. Yes? We do with the senior people when we're doing weights. And it also depends on the schedule. Like the younger, like we have younger swimmers that swim until 9 o'clock at night, so they have to do dry land before. So, you know, I think with the younger swimmers, we usually do it before because it just fits into the scheduling better. Because you all have the same deal, right? You've got pool space, you've got to fit a lot of people into a short amount of time. We are no different. How important is aerobic conditioning for 12 and unders versus 13 and overs, regardless of the amount of swimming background? Very important. And it's important because we go back to this capacity. It kind of builds their capacity to do all the other stuff. You know? I love the examples, right? College programs use utilization training most of the time. That's what they should use. Okay? You know, Os Maluli, Olympic champion in the 1500 meters and 10K, right? Well, you know, you can look at what he's doing in training now and make a decision about what you want to do with your high schoolers, but you may want to look back to what he did before, and that was swim with Schubert for about 3 or 4 years. So it's a natural progression of capacity and then utilization. Rebecca Sony, Tom Spieling, capacity and then Salo, utilization. That's what young coaches, I think, sometimes miss. You just want to see the end product, and you feel like, well, if we can get this result, and you can get this result with younger kids by doing that kind of training, but it's short-sighted because they just reach a point and they won't get better because they don't have a capacity to move to the next level. You have to really think about where they are in their progression. So I think that aerobic training is very important. I like it for 12 and unders because before puberty, research tells you you can increase heart and lung size with aerobic training. For sure. After, not so much. Does it help everybody? Yes, it does. But if you really wanted to build the boat that's going to be able to break a world record, I don't know how you can do it without doing aerobic training when they're 11, 12. And again, it's appropriate aerobic training. It's not 3 5,000s. Maybe it's, you know, 6 500s sometimes. Just, if you really think about it, what makes sense really makes sense. If something's really out there, treat it carefully. There are times to have something that's out there because you want to sort of push your boundaries. But if you're always out there, you're always out there. And you know who they are. So there's some in here. There's some in every coaching thing. I'm accused of being out there sometimes. Best warm-up prior to the race. I did have a lot of questions about the meet warm-up. This is what I like to go with. And it's just a very basic. And I will say that once I kind of teach this to younger swimmers, at MBAC, we sort of program the younger swimmers with what we think they should do. And after that, we kind of leave them alone. Like when I go to a meet with my group, they just warm up. And I don't really tell them what to do. They ask, I'll say, why don't you know by now what to do? And then we'll figure it out. But it's something, this is, you know, the go-to 800 mixer, which means either by 50s or 25s, you go free and then something else. So 50 free, 50 something else. I'd go 600 worth of kicking. And I'd vary the speed on it. So maybe every third 25 is fast or something like that, or 50. You can kind of, they learn how to do that. Speed play. 400 with a pull buoy. And it would be some sort of breathing pattern. I like 3, 5, 7, 9 by 100. And then a 200 IM drill. That's the basis of what they do. And what they do after that depends on the event and kind of who they are. Michael just does 25s. And Chase Kalish, most of our guys, they will just go a series of 25s. If they're in a 50-meter pool, they'll do a fast one and then an easy. In the short course, they'll just do them and rest. And they're not timed. They just build so their stroke feels good. I think one of the things that Murray Stevens taught me is you just don't want to leave your races in the warm-up pool. You know? You know, I've always felt like you had to really warm them up hard. You really don't. They'll warm themselves up, and you'd be surprised, particularly if they swim a lot of events. You don't want to be warming them up hard every time. So, you know, Michael would probably go, I would say, no more than 8 times, you know, like a 25. And I would watch, maybe give a little stroke help. And that's what he would do. Now, if you have someone like Allison, who quite frankly is always underwarmed up, because she might take, you know, 15 minutes to do this first 800. I'm not kidding. Just slow. I will put her on a watch so that she does something and gets her stroke together. And she'll typically do like maybe 350s, descending 1 to 3, you know, kind of one just over 200 pace, one at 200 pace, one below 200 pace. And if we think she needs another one, she'll do another one. If she feels good, that'll be it. But I let them have a lot of say in what they do in the warm-up because I want them to be able to warm themselves up. And I don't like to do a lot of time swims in the warm-up. I do it with Allison, I said, but I don't never time Michael in a warm-up ever. And some of the distance people, we might do some pace with a watch. But in general, I just like them to warm themselves up because it really makes them independent. And I think when the coaches get involved, we tend to overdo it. Yes? Oh, 13 or 14? Yeah, and it would be like, it starts at the meets where it doesn't really matter, right? The local meets, we just go in and they just get in and warm up. And you just kind of let them do it. And then you see how it is and you say, well, maybe you weren't warmed up enough. And he starts to put it, you know, you can kind of teach them. You don't do that at the nationals, right? You practice everything. So all the local meets, you kind of do that, and then they get comfortable with it, and then it just kind of naturally carries over. What you'll find is they're going to go to one of these meets and warm themselves up and have a really good meet, and that's going to be their warm-up forever. They'll just stick with that. That'll be their thing. It's kind of like their security blanket.